sets me off to a full-on chow. Yes, it does. The way you squeeze and tease knocks me to my knees. The slogan, baby, baby. The way you sway, okay, really wrecks my nerves. And I'm so excited, chow.
Welcome in, everybody. Getting started in about 45 seconds. Waiting for the man, the myth, the legend, Mr. Aaron Novello. Thanks everyone for tuning in. We're gonna get started in a couple moments. Hang tight. Welcome in, everybody. Thanks for joining us, ladies and gentlemen. Getting started in just a couple moments. Remember, this is an interactive live, so ask all the questions you can. Very important topics going on.
Yo, Brevy, bro.
Waiting on the man. All right, ladies and gentlemen, Aaron Novello, Jose Luis Morales.
Appreciate you waiting. Jose had me waiting because this is East Coast, West Coast, and we had to get this emergency meeting popping because we got all these people texting us and emailing us, and I wanted to get together some powerful leaders and the elite builders so we can address this head on. You know, what I'm aware of is in the 18 years I was selling real estate, you know, things changed as far as like how the business is done in terms of technology. This is a fundamental structural change to the business. At the same time, what I'm aware of is that our industry is very, particularly the, you know, professionals and people who have done this, you know, consistently over an extended period of time, it's very adaptive. And I know that with these changes, people who pivot will actually, I think, do better and actually make more money. So the question is just, how are we going to pivot? So for those of you who, I think everybody knows Hosey in the baby blue right now, looking smooth and easy in the baby blue.
I'm wearing cowboy boots. You guys want to see?
Well, I'm just wearing underwear, bro, so I can't stand up. And then we got the powerful Vicente Arzata, our resident kind of, contract specialist. So welcome, guys. I'm excited to hop on this live. I felt it was important as a leader to, just kind of address it, head on. So I guess the first thing we can start with is that I did a post, maybe like 2 months ago, where I said, hey, I think with a very high degree of probability here in the perhaps distant future or not so distant future, buyer's agents will have to negotiate a portion, if not all, of their fee. And, two things came from this particular settlement, which, by the way, it has to be approved by the judge, hasn't been approved yet. Let's say it does. We'll go with the assumption that it will. There were two main changes that were agreed to. One was that compensation can no longer be put in MLS for a buyer's agent. Now, it did not say you cannot offer compensation to a buyer's agent. It just said that it can't be put in the multiple listing service. And what I'm aware of is for commercial real estate, a lot of transactions are done without the commission being put anywhere. And when somebody makes an offer, they kind of do an LOI, a letter of intent. And in that offer is the purchase sales price and also the professional fee that the buyer's agent is looking to get on that sale. And then it becomes a negotiation. The second rule is that if you do work with buyers, you must have a buyer broker's agreement kind of authorized. I think the goal and objective there is to have upfront conversations in terms of compensation and what that's going to look like. So Vicente, you've been selling real estate longer than me and Jose, probably combined. So talk to me a little bit about your first kind of reaction to those two rule changes.
Thank you, Aaron. This is something that has been going on in the back burner for a long time, and technology and changes to the industry are the ones that are causing this. I'm in my third decade as a realtor, so I've seen a lot, especially after the year 2000. You call it that little thing they call the internet. So that brought a lot of changes. And I recall a conversation that we had a couple of years ago where I shared with you that the power shifting on the real estate relationships in the 60s and the before when organized real estate was put together, the power was really in the hands of the brokerage. Then with the birth of the internet, the power shifted to the hands of the agents. But now with internet 4.0 or higher, the power is shifting to the hands of the consumer. So how do is this change, this Burnett lawsuit and the settlement is going to affect our industry? First, like you say, it's going to be a different conversation between the seller and the listing agent.
A much more, I believe, skilled and professional conversation.
Correct.
Yeah, and I believe that one of the things I wrote down is that buyer's agents up until now have actually never had to come up with a formal presentation, the majority of them, formal presentation demonstrating what value they bring to the transaction, right? And I think that one of the byproducts of this is that a lot of agents, the vast majority of agents are buyer heavy. 60-70% of their transactions are on the buy side. So a lot of those agents, I think, will perhaps not have the capacity or the bandwidth to make that pivot, right? Or have those skills. I think the ones that do pivot, do have a formal presentation and basically list buyers, will actually make the same, if not perhaps a little bit more, as long as they can demonstrate the fact that they add value to the transaction and specifically how they add value. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely, because for the better part of my career, 25 years, then you sat down with the seller and you had an exclusive agreement for compensation, but majority of the buyers didn't. And the level of skill, is that something that I've learned from you over the years, that the level of skill necessary to represent a buyer was not really, Mike Ferry used to call it a glorified door openers.
Yeah.
And that is going to have to change. That this lawsuit changes that.
Well,
the skill will get paid.
Well, here's what I wanted to, and this was new to me. I actually didn't know this, but Vicente shared this with me off camera. I think, Vicente, you said that if this that has happened has already happened in other countries, meaning that like it's already happened. Did you say in France or France. Did you say like where has this happened? Because it's funny because if you look around sometimes, something that maybe appeared new to us may have already happened somewhere else. So like, do you have any insight on where that happened? Any insight on how that works in France or some of these different countries?
It is a great question, Jose Luis. The fact that France is already operating that way, and also Australia is happening with the transactions, have decoupled the compensation from the seller into the buyer's agent. And that's one of my questions. My question is, like, what does this lawsuit does to an already wounded U.S. real estate market?
Yeah.
And that we still have to see.
Well,
actual market.
But I think that there is I love that we're doing this, by the way. It's so cool to like try and get out ideas of believable people. So I think that with a high degree of probability, being that volume has already gone down 19, like depending on geographic area last year, 19 to 30%, depending on where it was, 6 million to 4 million transactions. And let's say the majority of buy sides, I mean, the majority of agents are buy side heavy, 60-70% of their deals are on the buy side. I also think a byproduct of this is over time, let's say over a 5 to 10 year time span, I do think professional fees will come down over time as a result of the decoupling, right? Now, I also think that as a ramification of this, one of the things I wrote down is that teams that are focused on buy side, because what the model has been since the internet, which was the last structural change to the business, right? Because it used to be like nobody had any information about real estate, and real estate agents had a basically a monopoly of information. Well, that got decoupled, that got decentralized, right? Democratized with the internet. And then the model became buy leads and then offer out, you know, and then work the buy side leads, because the majority of those leads are buyers. And that works when you know that you can expect let's say all commissions are negotiable. We're all aware of that. Mm-hmm. Let's say a 2-3% commission on the buy side. That model functions. When that changes with a very high degree of probability, that has a problem with that model. Cause I know that the majority of teams don't operate on
just listings,
like really fundamental good economics, where the team lead usually is in production, right? Because they need to be in order to be profitable. And the team itself doesn't actually, they operate on very thin profit margins. So if that revenue drops by a third, that makes that model problematic over time.
Vicente, When there was the MLS book before, did they advertise?
Hey, I feel like we just went to a cave and we're like, tell us, old man, did you used to use tablets when you?
Yeah.
I ask is, there was a video by Glenn Sanford today, and he was talking about how before, I think he said something about that the buyer's agent compensation wasn't advertised at some point, or it was on the list. So he said something that I didn't quite understand. Okay. So I kind of wanted to ask the wise Vicente.
And it's a great question. In my experience, my opinion, what I remember is that the buyer's compensation was not advertised. It was anywhere until the birth of the MLS in the early
2000s. Until the MLS came about. So
when the MLS came about, then cooperating agreements and share compensation was advertised. Then in the midst of settling this lawsuit, one of the things that NAR and Zillow and Melo and Willow and Trulia and Zulia did is they began publishing the buyer's agent's commission as a way to appease this this lawsuit. And now that this settlement changes that. Okay. So another brutal change to the market, right? When I started, the MLS changed the market. Zillow changed the market. Now this lawsuit changes the market again.
Again. And I think one of the things I wrote down too is that Zillow's model is very much so in jeopardy as a result, because their model is they take our data, sell it back to us, so agents will make money on the buy side transactions, and they can charge 30-40% referral fees with like Zillow Flex and whatnot. At the same time though, what I just mentioned in terms of the economics of that, that no longer makes sense if I don't know that I can expect a 2-3% commission on the buy side.
Right. Here is something else, Aaron. CoStar bought homes.com. How much they invest? Millions and millions of dollars. They had 3 commercials at the Super Bowl, and their model is based on feeding off the agents. They became the middleman. They get the consumer, and then buyer's agents buy these leads, and their model, believe it or not, is based on the agents will not call those leads. So I discovered that these big companies, they sell leads to 5 different agents on the same market, the same leads, and that's how they make tons of money.
Yeah, I think there was a statistic where they sold like something crazy, like, I don't know, like 20 million leads, but there were only like 4 million transactions in the year, right? Or 100 million leads, something crazy like that. Well, so, and what Homes.com does is that they give all the leads back to the listing agent.
They changed it, which
I can understand why agents would like that. Now, I'm also curious to see, and then we can talk about kind of strategically some things that people can be doing, right? So first, I think it makes sense, like, hey, what do I think will be first level consequence, second level consequences? And then as a practicing real estate agent, how do I need to start presenting?
Beautiful.
Right? Like, how do I need to start presenting on the listing side? How can I demonstrate value on the buy side? And that sort of thing. So the other thing that I wrote down here is that I think another consequence is that smaller brokerages are going to get like hammered. So people who have like 60 agents, like 100 agents or less, like they're going to get hammered because they were already having a hard time from an economic perspective. But if revenue has the potential of going down, they're going to have to, and every brokerage is really like involved in these lawsuits. So they have to spend some sort of resources or time or money to fight them or to pay. And that takes time away and resources for adding value to agents and investing in technology and also not doing mergers and acquisitions. So I think what will happen is they will have to move to models where they can get rid of expenses like cloud-based models, which we are at the E to X.
Exactly.
I believe that will happen too. What are your guys' thoughts on that?
I think that you're absolutely right. See, everything is commission based, and one of my mentors said that realtors, we are the piece of meat between the two breads.
Yeah.
So as commissions are under pressure because is the money that is in the middle.
Jose thought that was funny for some reason. I don't know why.
He's such a little kid, bro.
He has heard me say this before.
You said that he was breads, and he was like, ha ha, ha ha, ha ha.
You didn't think that was funny? Come on.
One of my title reps calls them Vicente-isms. But anyways, moving forward, because the commissions are under fire, I saw this coming a long time ago. And I've always throughout my career, Jose knows this, I've been extremely fond of buyers because that moral salary that gives you, seeing them put the key on their first home and help them build wealth and having call me after 20 years and say, I want you to represent my daughter because you help us with this. And that is cool, right? But But what happens to the skill? I remember that we used to give guarantees. A client, if I am the consumer, Aaron, and I want representation, I want to see value. Now that I'm gonna have to pay, I have to see value. We had these conversations over and over with listing sellers, where they say, "Okay, I'm interviewing three agents. Where's your value?"
That's right.
And so then the ability to represent that value, and then getting the contract.
Yeah, but I think we're assuming that listing agents and sellers aren't going to provide compensation anymore.
No, I agree with you. I think that they will. And I think that they'll do it in one of two ways. I think they'll do it either creatively by offering concessions, because you are allowed to offer concessions. Yeah. So let's say you're like, "Hey, I'm going to offer like a $10,000 closing cost concessions," but that'll help the buyer to pay perhaps a little bit of the buyer's agent's professional fee. I think you can also, as a listing agent, we're kind of getting ahead of ourselves in terms of like what you can do, mm-hmm. is now you, and I, we've been talking about this for like a year, like presenting with options. So it's like, listen, you know, we have a few options at our disposal in terms of compensation, and it is a tool that we use to market the property in terms of, you know, exposure, right? Obviously what we offer out or what we choose to offer out, whether it's a mixture of concessions or perhaps a little bit in terms of the compensation for the buyer's agent, that will increase the probability that we can get more views, which ultimately is going to end up with you netting the most money possible. So we're going to go over the options that you have, and I want you to feel completely comfortable with whatever we end up choosing. You're the boss, and I'll support you 100%. Now you have a menu of options. So a menu on the listing side could be, you know, whatever it is in your geographic area, but let's say it's like, okay, let's say it's 2%. Again, all commissions are negotiable. So let's say it's 2%. And you're like, all right, well, at 2%, this is what you get. You get, you know, kind of the basic stuff, mm-hmm. right? Now let's say it could be 2.5%. At 2.5, we add some things. Maybe we add a Matterport. Maybe we add this, we add that. Then at 3%, it's the full Monty, right? We'll have an appraisal done before we mm-hmm. put it on the market. We'll pay for the appraisal. We'll have an inspection done. We'll give you up to $1,000 for whatever comes up in the inspection, plus what you get at the 2.5 and the 2, right? So it's a menu of options. And then they decide on that. And then they're like, okay, great. Now that we've made a decision on that, whatever they settle on. So now we just have to have a conversation in terms of compensation. Now, I want to be clear. Mm-hmm. What I'm aware of, and you may be aware of, is we're not obligated to provide any compensation at all. And that is a fact. What I'm also aware of is that I know that the professional fee is a tool that we use to market the property. Can I explain to you what I mean? And they're like, well, yeah. Well, let's say you were a buyer's agent and you knew now that you were going to have a negotiation with the buyer in terms of your professional fee. And there was a property that was offering out some form of compensation to the buyer's agent. I'm curious, would you perhaps be a little bit more excited about showing and selling that property? And they'll be like, well, yeah. Well, why is that? Well, you know, I'll have to have less of a conversation with the buyer. Exactly. Right. So there's different ways that we can do that. And I'd like to go over them with you so you can decide what you feel is best. One way is we can offer out concessions, right? In doing that, in closing cost concessions, we free up a little bit of their capital so they can have a conversation, right? And it's easier to have that conversation. The other way we can do it is we can offer out some form of compensation. Now, I'm not able to put that in the multiple listing service. However, when agents call and they speak to my staff, we'll tell them exactly what it is, right? Or we can do both. And if we do both, we would dramatically increase the probability that we can get you an offer that's reasonable, acceptable. Now, if we do both, here's what that would look like. Maybe it's another point. Maybe it's a point, like whatever that ends up working out to be. And then you'd be like, okay, so based on what you feel is, you know, makes the most sense, and based on what you're looking to accomplish and why, and the time frame you'd like to make it happen in, which one of these options do you think would serve you and your family best? And then shut up. And then they'll make a decision, which, Jose, you already do that now.
Right.
In terms of all of the added, like, you know, services that you provide in the menu of options.
I think what's going to be interesting, though, is like, let's say that you publish it in terms of a concession. I think that, like, if buyers see that there's a 2% concession, I think naturally they're going to be like, oh, I'll use that 2% for my closing costs versus, hey, that's just what I'm going to use to pay the buyer's agent.
Yeah, instead. I agree. I agree with you because people's natural disposition is to be selfish. Like they're going to
exactly. I think what the way I see the kind of model working out instead of the concessions, and some people may offer the concessions, but I think that if they do offer the concessions, I think that most of the buyers are going to want to be like, hey, look, that 2% belongs to me and I could use that for my closing costs, or I can use that for my this. I'm going to negotiate something different with you. I think I see it playing out more like on the commercial side, like on LoopNet, like you submit an offer on the listing. I think listing agents are going to be getting a lot more calls to the office like, hey, I like the property. Are you guys offering any compensation? Is your seller offering any compensation to the buyer side as a result of doing this? And if so, what are they offering? And I think that's probably the way that it somewhat goes on the commercial side as well.
I agree. And I think one of the pivots is because as a listing agent, you know, I would list like 150 homes a year. And I did that for over a decade, like year after year after year. And because of the way it was structured, the amount of interaction I needed to have was very little. And now I think it'll be more, but you'll need to have like staff who can answer.
You're going to be getting a lot more phone calls.
Or a VEA who can answer all those questions. You're going to be getting a lot more phone calls asking and kind of negotiating. You know what I'm saying?
And I think what's also going to happen is that there's going to be sellers that say, yes, I still want to offer a buyer's compensation whenever they call, basically tell them that we're offering 2.5%. And then there's going to be sellers that say, no, I don't want to offer anything. What I also think is going to happen is that some of these buyer brokers agreements are going to be based on different situations. So like, hey, if the seller is offering compensation of 2.5%, you don't pay anything on your end. If the seller's offering 2%, you pay half of a percent. If the seller's offering 1%, you pay 1%. So I think it's going to be like based on different scenarios, just like I do like on listings.
Exactly.
You list properties based on different scenarios. And then the other thing that's going to happen is that
there's going to be different types of agreements.
I think there's going to be different types of agreements too. I think there's going to be agreements based on, hey, I'm only representing you on this one offer for this one property, or I'm representing you for the next six type of months as well too. So exactly. I think there's going to be like a variety of different options.
Excuse me, and that's already happening. The California market is already there. We already have, and then in the purchase agreement, I believe it's in 318 or 3B, where it states, okay, we will agree to whatever the seller is paying, right? But it's definitely gonna have the conversation, the new conversation with the buyer, because when buyer's agents represent buyers, and if they're not willing, able, ready, and realistic about what they're trying to obtain. And one of the things that I've always done is, okay, let's have a conversation with this buyer. Let's do a buyer broker agreement. We've been doing, our team has been doing buyer broker agreements for over 2 years already when I saw this coming.
Yeah.
But am I going to work in a 3-bedroom, 2-bathroom, midtown, easy to buy? Or is my buyer looking for a pink zebra? Am I going to have a lot of work built into finding that specific track, that specific floor model? Am I going to be sending letters out to try to find this specific home? How much the buyer's agent is going to be working to obtain what their clients are looking for and how easy. So that will be my guess. How much work am I going to put into this client? And just like attorneys and doctors do it, guys, right? How much work am I going to do for what am I going to get in return? It's value.
Yeah, no, I agree. And the way I think about it, I thought about this the other, like I was like, well, it's kind of like
zebras, guys. Huh? Zebras are striped.
Oh my god! he actually thought that was funny. This guy. First it was the sandwich thing. Now it's the zebra thing. Bro,
Come on, Aaron. So, come on, bro. So,
you have a crazy imagination, like, dude.
This is not like it's no different. Like when you call a FSBO.
Yeah.
Like you're trying to negotiate. You're like, okay, well, like, you know, we help a lot of for sale by owners when they sell their homes, purchase our next one. So I'm curious, like, you know, are you staying here locally? You're going to go someplace else. Okay. And if we brought you a buyer, you know, are you compensating agents for bringing you a buyer? They're like, yeah, I'll give you 1%. You're like, okay, well, that's really generous. I appreciate that. And then, you know, you continue the conversation and then perhaps you just have a negotiation between what they're willing to pay and what they're willing to offer out. You see what I'm saying? It's the same thing. Like, it's really not. Look, everybody's coming to Jose's. They're like,
hey, I know everybody's agreeing with my point, bro.
Hey, he's spitting facts about the sandwich and the zebras, bro.
You know what's funny, Aaron? I hope when I get old, bro, I still have a sense of humor. I
hope so too. Oh, you're talking about me? Wow, dude. Look at this guy.
Boy,
you're talking about
boy, passive aggressive.
So I don't perceive it being that different. And what I just laid out there in terms of like the options, like if you're as a seller and you know, you've been doing that for a long time, Jose, in terms of like having all of these ancillary services that you offer. I think the same is true or going to be true on the buy side. You're going to have to give a formal presentation on specifically how you add value, what ancillary services they will have access to. You know what I mean? And then be like, hey, here's what our compensation is. And we can get to that in a few ways. Some of the offers that we're going to make, they'll be offering out compensation, like you said, Jose. And some of them won't. If they offer out some compensation, then great. You know, then you wouldn't be responsible for compensation. If it's anything less than this, you would have to be responsible for that. And then just be quiet.
Right.
And then it could even be like, if they don't offer any compensation, then this is the flat fee or this is the minimum that I would accept in terms of compensation. That would mean that would come from your side, basically. But correct. Even if they're not offering anything, like you could still submit an offer and basically request whatever you want. And it's really going to be based on a seller's net. I think it depends by market. I think in a buyer's market, like meaning like, sellers are going to be like, hey, I got to get this property sold. Let me offer something. But in a 2020 market, when the market is going like this and there's 20 offers on a property, that's where I see it getting a little bit skinnier for buyer's agents. And even listing agents may be like, hey, look, like, you know, like they're not offering anything, you know, like on it. Do you want there's 20 other offers on the table as well too. So I think that's it. Also depends by market. So I think the whole part of the point is, as agents, and this is something that Aaron and I, Vicente, have been preaching, is just about getting skills. Meaning, like, it's about like learning how to present, learning how to negotiate commissions. Like when I go on listing appointments, you have to negotiate the commission, and sometimes you have to negotiate it based on different scenarios.
Like almost every time.
You know what and I mean? There's been times where I have to negotiate a commission based on performance, like meaning, hey, if I sell it for this price, I get X. If I don't sell it at that price, I get Y. There's been times where I negotiate like a flat fee. There's been times where I negotiate a lower percentage. There's times where we take a shorter listing. So it's just learning how to have these conversations with your client and then offering options. I think that the ones that are going to be hurt the most are the ones, this is what I do. This is all I do. And I don't charge a penny below this. There's just going to be a lot more different options.
Do you know who's going to have real hard problems? People who say, no, any other questions? And it's going to be like, oh, you're going to starve to death doing that because they have so many different options. So I think the two things that are percolating to the surface that are very important is skills, the skill of, you know, negotiating, the skill of presenting. Yes. Then the second thing that's percolating to the surface is being open to providing options and choices, because truthfully, that's the way we buy every other product. You know, like I always have options. I have the cheap option, I have the middle option, and I have the bougie option. And some people choose the bougie option because it's easy and it's quick and it's painless. The other people are super cheap, and you get to make a decision as to who you want to work with. And then I think the third thing that is true is being able to demonstrate value. Mm-hmm. And I think that demonstrating value is a multiple pronged approach. One is with tangible value, right? Like if you list and sell with us, you get to use our moving truck for free. If you list and sell with us, we'll, you know, stage the home for you when we list it with you. And if we help you to buy a home, then there's this other ancillary service that we can provide you with on the buy side, right? And being creative in that way. That's one way of demonstrating value. Another way of demonstrating value is in the digital world. So it's like, do you think that having like tons of reviews online now is going to be even more impactful when people are making decisions about who, what agents that they're going to have? It's like, of course. Do you think having a digital footprint or a personal brand where you are known as an agent in your marketplace who does a lot of transactions, it's like 100% that's going to, because that'll help you to demonstrate value, right? Because there's perceived value and then there's tangible value.
I think at some point too, it's like about reading between the lines. And this is something that I think I'm very skilled at. Like, what are they not telling me? You know? So I think that the reason they're putting a lot of emphasis.
Wait, do you see this? Bro, did Ricky do that? Oh, I love Ricky for that, bro.
Hey, Ricky, you can't do that. Come on.
Way to go, Ricky. That's 10 full points for Ricky.
Hey, I think Ricky's forgetting who pays the bills here. You know, like, I'm just kidding. Come on, Ricky. All right. So what I was saying is about reading between the lines. Let's see if that zebra disappeared right now. I'm kidding. But I think the reading between the lines, I think that the reason they're putting so much emphasis on you can still now you can offer buyer concessions listed on the MLS. I think that they're saying like, hey, look, part of the transition is going to be instead of offering a publicized MLS commission, now people are going to say, hey, look, we're offering some sort of credit, like a 2-3% credit to the buyers. But I think that could backfire on people. Now, I also think that like there's going to be more of an emphasis on people wanting to become listing agents now.
Oh.
I think that when people are going to be like, okay, like, do I want to represent a buyer where my commission is not guaranteed and maybe this buyer only wants to pay me 1% because they're a VA buyer or an FHA buyer, why don't I learn how to take listings? And I think that that could lead to a little bit more competition on the listing side, meaning that like more people chasing the same amount of sellers, which forces more competition as well too. So well,
commissions are going to suffer on general. Only the agents that are able to provide the most value will still make a very decent
Still like they'll be insulated, yeah. But I think as a whole, like let's say over 10 years, let's say the average has been, again, all commissions are negotiable, average has been like 5-6%. It'll probably go down to like 4-ish or something, you know what I'm saying? Like total, cumulatively. And I think to your point, Jose, I think that that's an accurate assessment. I think for those agents like me,
I second that.
That have a particular set of skills in listing property in high volume, that becomes very valuable as a skill set, not only to be able to do that for yourself, but then to like teach other people how to do it. I think that leaders anticipate and everybody else reacts. So if I was going to anticipate moving forward what that landscape would look like, what I would be focused on now, again, you can learn how to list buyers and be really good at that. And some people will do that and be a ninja at it. What I would propose is like learn how to be a listing machine.
And that does excite me, Aaron, because the market wins, the consumer wins, the real estate transaction wins with more skilled agent,
correct,
able and experienced helping their clients.
Yeah, I think it's a net
win with that.
Yeah, I think it's a net positive for consumers, and it's actually net positive for our industry because what happens is you know, at any given time, you know, we have like 1.5 million. Agents, and let's say there's 4 million sales. Well, there's like only three sales for every, or two, you know, whatever that is, 2.5 sales for every agent. And we should have a lot less agents, right? Because a lot of those agents do like 4 deals a year, you know? So I've always said like, there should be like a criteria to call yourself an agent. Like maybe you could call yourself like a junior agent if you've done less than 20 deals, you know, before you can actually call yourself an agent. Well, what this will do though, in my opinion, is it'll get rid of a lot of agents that are part-time, that are not professional, that are doing 4 deals a year. It just
the amateur is going to separate. Amateur. Mike said that.
I also think what's going to happen is that each little city or county is going to pick up certain customary things. So what I think is going to happen is that a lot of the heads of certain companies or certain counties are going to end up getting together and say, okay, what, how are we going to handle this? And how are we going to basically, what's going to be the, how are we going to adapt to this? So I think that there's going to be counties that say, well, look, like most of our agents are going to offer like a concession basically instead. And that's technically like a buyer's agent compensation and a part of a concession. Some counties are going to say, look, we're not going to advertise a commission. And every time somebody calls in, that's the way it's going to be handled. Or I think that different industry heads, and I think it's going to be customary based on your location, just like it is customary in different parts of California or different parts of the country. Like in different parts of California, there's areas where the buyer pays for all of the closing costs instead of the seller and the buyer splitting it. So there's going to be certain things that are customary based on different areas. And I think what's going to end up happening is just different leaders in different local municipalities are going to get together and come up with some sort of
customary stuff.
Customary. Traditional basically?
Stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, and here's another question. You're absolutely right, Jose. I think that is going to happen. Like some markets will not register any suffering. Some markets will struggle more with this change. And there's another animal in the room that we haven't even addressed yet. And that is big money, okay? Lenders. Because a VA, an FHA, are lenders going to allow buyers to finance their buyer's representation? Is that going to happen? That's one of my questions. So there's a lot of unanswered questions that we don't even have the results yet. But what is going to happen? Money wants to get land. So is that going to be an issue if the lending comes from the side of the buyer? Who is the lender? What's going to happen with that?
Thought of, because there's a law that was passed, I don't know when, that prevents that from happening. But like you're saying, like money wants to lend, so they may go to people. And maybe what it'll be is they can only finance a certain amount, like a half a point or up to a certain amount, like 5,000, like whatever that is. And then that'll help piece together, you know, the professional fee. So between that, maybe the buyer, maybe some concessions, it works out.
Because we're going to have the renegade with 365 days on the market that said, I am not going to pay a buyer's agent commission.
Yeah.
And he's going to be sitting at his house for 365 days, being able to go nowhere just out of principle, right? Not a lot of common sense.
Yeah,
there.
One of the agents in our chat, like he said, like, oh, well, you know, I know that listing, like, it's funny, dude. There's like all this animosity amongst like between listing agents and buyers agents. I don't know why. Like, we're doing the same thing, guys. Like, we're all trying to help each other. Which I think that's also a really good byproduct, is because it'll force us, I think, to interact with each other more. But he was saying, like, you know, listing agents are greedy and they'll keep all the commission. I'm like, only the ones who don't want to sell any real estate will.
Correct.
Because like 50% of the time, at least, or 60% statistically, it's going to be an agent from the community that brings us a buyer. So it's just, I think the agent, here's what I think, okay?
Not only that, but if an agent gets known to have that type of reputation in their market, then that's going to affect their business, because people are going to be like, oh, that agent never pays out a buyer's agent commission. That agent never distributes any of it. That agent's very likely going to develop a reputation where people don't want to show as a listing.
They don't want to show the property. That's exactly right. And or they're difficult to work with. If
there's that agent that is always trying to get the other side paid instead, now it's like people are like, hey, I'm going to go work with Jose because I know Jose always tries to help get the other side paid as well too.
Exactly. Yeah,
that's exactly
right. Plus he wears cowboy boots and likes zebras. So here's even with the internet, I'm aware that like with the internet, people are like, oh, that's it. Agents are gone. They're going to disappear. You know, there's always like, I think like every 3 years or so, there's like something like, okay, we're all going to disappear. And I think the reason that real estate agents have been involved in transactions, even after the internet, is because of human behavior. It's a huge sale. It's complicated and there's lots of paperwork. The consumer wants us, but the consumer also doesn't want to pay us as much. So the consumer always gets what they want. They want us involved in the transaction, but perhaps, you know, earning a little bit less. So I believe that the agents of the future are the following: very highly skilled salespeople. Not like, you know, sitting, doing open houses, and that's their main mechanism. Like, they are highly skilled salespeople, okay, that have advanced training in sales.
I think very knowledgeable as well, too, yes, about what they are, like 1031 exchanges, Delaware, yes, statutory trust, seller financing,
correct,
title, estate,
probate, like lending, like they know all that. So they're highly knowledgeable, right? They're also, they understand media, and they're vertically integrated. I've been talking about vertical integration for a long time because
integration is going to be a huge fact.
Yes, because being okay, so our present situation is neither natural nor is it inevitable. So like us going to the grocery store, we think that that's like always going to be the case. That's neither natural nor is it inevitable, right? Just like we thought like, oh, this is always going to be this way. Yeah, it was that way for 100 years, but like now it's going to change, right? So it's neither natural nor is it inevitable. So for the last 4 years, at least maybe five, I've been sharing with people like, yo, you got to be vertically integrated as an agent, as an individual agent, not even as a brokerage firm, but as an agent. What does that mean? That means having multiple ways of getting compensated.
Correct.
Because most agents, their only way of getting compensated is through commissions.
Commission.
Well, what I'm suggesting to you, if there's a high degree of probability that moving forward, let's say over the next 10 years, that perhaps revenue will go down over time, well, me being vertically integrated will make up for that. So what would be an example of that? Receiving equity for doing your job performance-wise. So that's another form of compensation. So if I get $8,000, $16,000 a year in equity that can grow over time and pays a dividend, that's another form of compensation. Being with models that offer revenue sharing, that's another form of compensation that can make up for, you know, if you can earn, like last year I earned six figures in that from that specific space. Like if you can earn a meaningful amount of money, that can make up for compressions in revenue in other places. So I think agents of the future will be highly skilled, very hyper local experts, very knowledgeable, right? Very professional, understand media, and be vertically integrated.
Also, Aaron, all of that, I'm aware that all of that is true, and I support that. Also, being with a broker that is going to be there with you and amidst all of this, because one of the other things that I'm aware of is that the cost of doing business for both the listing agent and the buyer's agent is going to increase. So you're getting pushed from both sides. Commissions are gonna struggle on amounts and that, or the ability to get high commissions, only the skill will, and also the cost of doing business, fees of associations are gonna go up. Already, NAR said that we're about to go bankrupt with this $418 million out. What's gonna happen? The cost of doing business is going to increase.
Yeah,
everything. And you're also seeing leads that will be more money. Leads, yes, that want to pay going to cost more money. Associations are going to cost more money. Affiliations are going to cost more money. So all of this is also going to push agents to A, if they want to stay in the business, A, they have to work harder on the skill, and B, be with an organization that helps you get vertical income.
Yes.
From other sources, because the cost of business is going to increase.
I agree. 100%. How about you, Hosey?
Well, I think what Vicente said about the lenders, like potentially allowing financing, I think if that happens, that basically changes things forever.
It changes the whole conversation, but I'm aware that there's a law that specifically states.
I know.
Yeah. So they would have to.
That law was before this potential settlement.
Correct.
Meaning that, like.
And that ripple is going to get a DOJ.
But I also think that there's.
And I'm also going to change things.
I'm curious what you guys think. Because I also think. I'm seeing all these comments like, oh, like low income buyers and like all the other stuff. And I'm like, I think there's a pretty good argument to be made that we've made in America, specifically here, we've made buying a home like the barrier to entry, like as low as possible, bro. And we see people who have 50% debt to income ratios. They can barely bring the money to closing. They can't fix shit if it happened. The roof went. They got to take out lines of credit and all stuff. And we call that. We sit around and go like this. That's fantastic. But like, I think there's an argument to be made that like, like, yeah, like you probably should have to save a little bit more money. You should be more financially stable and sound before you like buy something, because there's all of these expenses that come with it.
But does that change homeownership in America?
I think a lot of times, even like for me, like whenever I bought my first property, that was the full $8,000 that I had. When I bought the commercial and residential, that was like literally everything I had. Now it's like, even now that I'm in that property now, it's like a good portion of
Yeah, but that's money. You, bro. You have a pattern of like pushing all your money into shit and then like having to work your way out of it, bro. I know, I don't do that shit.
For a lot of people, I don't think it's ever the perfect timing to do something. It always comes at a little bit of
No, I get that. I understand that. What I'm saying is like, you know, I've heard Grant Cardone say for a while that like we're moving towards being a renter nation.
Yeah.
And I like what I'm aware of is like having people buy homes with 3.5% down that now are like $500,000 or $600,000, like who can barely swing that. It's like we do it just to like aggressively push people into it. But, you know, I think if this causes some people to have to get more financially stable before they can like, I don't think that's bad. I think that stabilizes the market out. Instead of having like really big ups and really big downs, it's just like steady Eddie.
I don't know. I don't know that would be the case. Again, we're yet to see all of those changes and the ripple effects of this, without a doubt, changes who we are. but the effects and the new trends that the market will have, they're gonna take at least 24 to 36 months.
To establish. But I think we can all agree that being a dominant listing agent, it's always been valuable, but now it's like
super valuable.
Super valuable. Having that particular skill set, understanding that you're going to have to list buyers, and if you're going to work with buyers, you're going to have a formal presentation on how to do that. You're going to have to be able to present options on the listing side and on the buy side.
Negotiate.
You're going to have to negotiate, right, with not only buyers and sellers, but also other agents in terms of, because it's funny, dude, in the past, like agents would call me like, hey, I see you put this in MLS. Like, can we work on that? I'm like, no. Like, just make an offer. You know what I'm saying? Because that's how that was. But in this structure, like, that's not an approach that you would be able to take. So you're gonna have to negotiate more with everyone. I think you're gonna have, and I think you're gonna have to, again, understand media at a higher level, because it'll demonstrate you as the pro who knows what they're doing out of a sea of people.
It
comes with value. Exactly. It'll insulate you in terms of value. And then also being vertically integrated, like having multiple different ways of getting compensated.
And this might be a good thing even for agents that are skilled, you know, because I think that there's a good chance that the skilled agents could get a larger piece of the pie. Because if you're unskilled, it may drive you out of business. So I think it really comes down to just getting really good at having a value proposition. But I think that's the case for anything that you do, any type of business that you do. It's what are the problems in the industry and what can I solve them? What value proposition do you provide in the marketplace? How can you help make the process a little bit better for the customer in mind? The other thing that, and I think this is just for agents to realize, like the agents aren't going anywhere, guys. Like
no.
Zillow already tried to basically get rid of agents completely, and consumers spoke that they still want agents. And I'll tell you guys part of the reason I believe that people are still going to need agents. I think that people need agents because people are emotional and not logical.
Logical. If
everybody was 100% logical and said, oh, that, like, have you ever worked with a client that's just like logical? Like, oh, that makes sense. Like, let me do it, versus somebody that's like completely emotional and illogical. The reason people need agents is because if people were logical, this whole transaction could be done on a software. If everybody was logical and this was like, okay, like that's super simple. Like, let me do it that way. But because people were emotional and illogical, that's the reason sometimes you need two people to put something together for them and to help keep them calm whenever things get out of hand, basically.
Yeah. Yeah, we think,
or when people get emotional,
we think that we're thinking beings that feel when we're really feeling beings that think.
It's like divorce.
And what I'm aware of is
logical, they can come to an agreement.
Yeah, super easy. But what I'm aware of too is it's also like this endowment effect, which is like, because if I think something is like if somebody touches a coffee cup, right, and they hold it for like a minute, they will pay more for that coffee cup than they would one that they haven't touched, because they start to feel ownership. And there's nothing more that we feel ownership in than in the physical spaces that we live. That's why it's very difficult for people to have rational conversations about price. It's very difficult to rationally work through negotiations. So I'm in agreement with you. The consumer wants us. It's a big one of the biggest transactions, if not the biggest, for the majority of people that they'll ever do in their life, right? It's complicated. There's a lot of moving parts. There's tons of paperwork. They want someone to walk them through the process. They just don't want to pay us as much. That's all it is.
There's a great video on YouTube by Mike Delpreet. I think he did this presentation at the last Inman News in Las Vegas, where he explains the last mile.
Yeah.
And how
hard that is.
How hard that is for anybody. If Zillow and all the other companies could get rid of the realtors, would have done it already.
Yeah.
But we deliver that one last mile, like you say, Jose Luis, the emotional part, the logical part, all those intricate decisions that make the experience a pleasant experience of homeownership. We deliver that. And there's nothing else that can deliver by the human element.
That's right. So for those who, I'm in agreement with you, Jose, people who are highly skilled and focus on adding more value, whoever adds more value wins.
Yeah.
And what I'm aware of is that's what we're all about here at the Elite Builders at EXP. We're interested in adding value. That's why we wanted to hop on this call with you guys immediately. We're going to be doing another call for those that are in the organization on Wednesday. We're going to have Lars hop on and talk specifically about how to list buyers, because he's been doing that for a long time. He's a rock star, 2.6 million in GCI. He only worked in that business 58 days a year, because that's who we roll with. We roll with the Vicente Arzatas. We roll with the Jose Luis Moraleses. So let's go. Elite Builders, coast to coast. We'll catch you on the flip side, team.
Peace. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure. Thank you, Eric. Yeah.
Shoot your shot.